And today he will present another magic that is going to turn the toxic and liquid mercury into a solid and maybe safe. Thank you, Doron, for giving a lecture today.
So I decided to share with you something unique, an adventure in electrochemistry. This is an annual meeting of the Electrochemistry Society of Israel. In fact, I'm very excited about the first opportunity to meet in 3D after a year and a half or so. It's an adventure in material science and electrochemistry. Demonstrating solid-state mercury at ambient conditions and even at elevated temperature. It's nice to share with you the Via Dolorosa that we experienced on the way to publish the story. So about the, I have to acknowledge my colleagues. First of all, it's a very nice collaboration with my colleague Professor Aaron Gedanken and Professor Emeritus in my department, inspiring scientist, and we are good friends and we collaborate. And also we had collaboration from the Center in Portugal, in Braga, Portugal, and also with the friends at the Argo National Laboratory in USA, especially Dr. Khalil Amin. Which is a good friend, not just to me, but also to the Israel Chemical Electrochemical Society, and especially the energy electrochemistry subgroup. So topics. I'll talk about synthesis, and then I'll talk about how we have proven the solid nature. And here we had the Via Dolorosa, and because of that, I decided to share with you the story today. I'll talk about our chemical application with an emphasis on electrocatalysis, especially for hydrogen evolution, which is important. This relates to energy, electrology. So, mercury. Mercury is well known in our history. I have some typical examples in old medicine, in new applications, in modern health, and also in Indian medicine, and old medicine, and relatively new medicine in treating our teeth. And mercury, as a chemical entity, gained two Nobel Prizes, one at 1913 related to superconductivity, and then later on at 1959 by Jaroslav Krajewski from at that time Czechoslovakia, with the well-known polarography, the use of dropping mercury electrode that for a while was a very important analytical tool, maybe the best, the most important electrochemical analytical tool, until we got back with better methodologies. Shaping mercury is a challenge, there were attempts to shape mercury into nanoscale. Here, this is an example that I provide at cryogenic conditions. And this is an attempt from my colleague and co-author, Professor Gedanken, I believe maybe more than 20 years ago, here he tried to make a core shell of mercury embedded in carbon at a micrometric size. Now here, based on experience and based on the special experience that was developed by Professor Gedanken in sonar chemistry. Professor Gedanken is one of the leaders of this field. We decided to combine mercury, carbon, and sonar chemistry. Just a word about sonar chemistry. When we apply sonic energy at the right frequency, then we have the so-called cavitation phenomenon. The cavitation phenomenon is in fact a compression, adiabatic compression of bubbles, gas bubbles, in liquid. And due to the sonic energy and due to the size of the bubbles, we can obtain a very high local temperature at the nanostructure, at the nanosize dimensions in a liquid. And also we can gain a very high pressure, and this opened the door for very unique synthesis. And in fact, I believe that Professor Gedanken and my colleague published hundreds of papers demonstrating the unique capabilities which are being opened when you use sonar chemistry. You have unique pressure and temperature situation at average ambient temperatures, and amazing results, especially in order to obtain nanoparticles. So what we did here, first of all, the idea was to use graphene or graphene oxide as a substrate, and then to play with mercury and reduce the graphene. So we prepared the reduced graphene by this mode. We exfoliated graphite. It's a well-known process, nothing new here, but we did it in the lab. And then we went to the synthesis. We applied sonochemical energy into solutions with mercury, first of all without substrate, and of course we obtained dispersion, so we obtained what we could demonstrate that we have the right dispersion, but then we have coagulation and we have the formation of big drops again. But when we combine reduced graphite and mercury, and then we have dispersion and substrate dispersed in the solution, we came out with a very interesting situation. And in fact, this is the cartoon that describes what happened. And it took us with a lot of effort and several reviewing circles until we convinced the world that we really obtained what we intended to obtain. So it appears that when we apply sonic energy, we disperse the liquid mercury, and now with the special conditions which are being formed under the sonic vibration, then we throw the dispersed micro or nano, even nano droplets of mercury into the substrate, and then we have interactions that can solidify the mercury and keep particles, embedded particles, stable in a solid state at ambient conditions. So this is microscopic data after reactions, and we can see that indeed we have dispersion of mercury all over, and we analyze mercury, so the dispersion works. But now comes the question, what we really obtain. So by doing more high resolution microscopy, we could demonstrate that we indeed obtain very unique particles which cannot be considered as nanodroplets. We see here phases, And so we suspected that we really indeed solid nanoparticles embedded and stabilized by the reduced graphene substrate. So this is a typical X-ray diffraction pattern that we obtained from the product. And we definitely see here, of course, it's broad light because of the nanostructure, but we definitely recognize the fingerprint of mercury. But we are sure that this should be quite a convincing evidence, but nobody wanted to listen to us, and they didn't took this chart too seriously. So we had to work hard for convincing, and so let's go further. First of all, it appears that we obtained indeed the so-called alpha mercury, and only that because of this situation that are being developed under the sonic conditions, when we apply certain pressure of something like gigapascal, so we are in this region here, where indeed and temperature is not a problem. We obtain very high temperature due to the cavitation phenomena, and thereby the fact that we obtained exclusively the homohedral phase is not surprising. It fits well the phase diagram of Mercury. So going further, our reviewers told us that, of course, it cannot be solid Mercury. You obtain probably some compounds, maybe carbide, maybe it was simply carbon mercury compounds or even oxides. So we did a simple test and compared all the reference materials that were suggested by the reviewers using thermal analysis, and we demonstrated our material, you know, the red one is really unique. We don't get any of the materials suggested by the reviewers. Then the next complaint was that, well, you obtained probably amalgam. There's no way that you get a solid state mercury at ambient temperature, so it's like amalgam. So this was, of course, eliminated, but then we had some sodium and potassium, and they said somehow there is an infiltration of sodium potassium and you had amalgam. So we did very careful analysis by ICP, and this is just some results, and it appears that we may have some trace of these elements. You cannot avoid them, but not at a concentration that really form amalgams, and especially that we form amalgam with sodium and potassium. It's moisture sensitive, and you can easily get a fire. Sorry, you can easily get a fire. Just a minute, I'll get back here. So if you expose it to ambient air, you can get even fire, and this is of course very reactive material. And we demonstrate stability at really ambient temperature. So then we went to X-rays, X-ray absorption, near edge spectroscopy. It's a well-known methodology you need for that synchrotron. Unfortunately, we have good friends at the Argonish Laboratory, Dr. Khalil Amin, battery hero, by the way, a very good collaborator and friend and colleague. And they, we sent them samples of all the reference compounds as suggested by the reviewers. And so here you have the results of the zincs, and this is the derivative analysis in order to see better what's going here in this region, and here you can see that the comparison, and it appears that we have indeed unique situation. The conclusion from the experts in Argonne Laboratory that we have here a partially charged material. So we made a progress, and then we moved, we turned to calculations. Here, Professor Ilya Greenberg from our department, he did for us calculations, and he modeled the situation of Mercury clusters on reduced graphene oxide. And then it appears that there is a natural charge transfer. So we built this model. Sorry. We built these models of even hundreds of atoms on a sheet of reduced oxygen graphite, and definitely found naturally there is charge transfer between the metallic mercury and the reduced graphene oxide. There's oxygen there. And there is charge separation. The mercury become slightly positively charged. And then this now he did this calculation on flat area, but here we have a particle that is embedded in the graphene sheet. So this calculation demonstrate a mechanism that can really stabilize solid-state mercury at ambient conditions. So now after the measurements demonstrating the partial charge transfer, first of all calculation and also experimental work by Zins, we could come up with the following mechanism where we, by sonochemistry, we disperse the particle, we throw them at high pressure and power to the graphene sheets. I'm sorry. And now then they are being embedded within the material and being stabilized by partial charge transfer. So now we are, at least we, at this stage we convinced the reviewers that we had a really solid state. But we went further and we did some thermal analysis. So what we did, in fact, I'll show you the entire story. So we did a very careful thermal analysis, and we stopped at certain points and measured what we obtained by XRD and by microscopy. And it appears that if you look at the thermogram, so picking coming up at endothermal related to phase transition, like melting, boiling, and when picking going down, it's of course some exothermal reaction with contamination, maybe with oxygen. So what we can see here, this is the reduced graphene, this is our substrate, which is exactly what we accept, nothing interesting, but our product, which is nanoparticles of mercury embedded in the graphite, here we see indeed endothermal peaks that relates to melting, and here, and then later on even we could demonstrate boiling. We went to a higher temperature, and when we stopped it here, and even up to before we obtained melting and like something like 150 degrees C, we still see the solid state mercury. So it appears that we really demonstrate here stability. We went further with the thermal analysis, and now we did some cycling. So first of all, the reference, this is cycling of mercury. So it goes, this is the melting, this is the melting, and this is solidification, nothing interesting in this region. So when we start with our material, and we start, we went along a white temperature range, so here we are in our solid state at ambient temperature, and then here we have the melting. After melting, of course, we see the change in the morphology of the drops, and we stop at each point, and we look through the morphology. So here we have melting, and then, but once we have melting, we cannot have a reversible formation of the solid state particle because simply of coagulation. And indeed, after we have melting, now we have a circle which demonstrates liquid mercury. So with this, we went to we we demonstrate, of course, that we have stability up to a high temperature. And what we demonstrate further, that we could obtain these solid state nanoparticles not just on reduced carbon, reduced graphene, but also also on other carbonaceous substrate like graphite, carbon nanotubes, other type of graphenes. It appears that we have a phenomenon of stabilization under the sonochemical situation. So this is a general phenomena. This can be also applied to other soft metal or even liquid metals. And experimental work is underway. So now we turn to electrochemistry. It appears that this is interesting. We're inspired by work with solid state mercury. Mercury is very was widely explored in electrochemistry. So we did some experiments. It was interesting to see to what is the electrochemical effect that we obtain. So we prepare electrodes. We have this suede type cell with reference electrodes. So we had good cells, I would say healthy from electrochemistry point of view. And we measured this simple ferric ferrum reaction, also zinc deposition, and also hydrogen evolution. So let's go through the electrochemical measurements. First of all, a simple reaction, what is called a simple out-of-sphere reaction of this couple. And we demonstrate, and it appears that our real reference, we have two references here. First of all is the reduced graphene oxide without the mercury, but also the mercury electrode on the substrate, which is glassy carbon electrode. So you can see that when we compare reduced graphene oxide or glassy carbon, we see a lousy behavior. With the mercury, we obtain the right expected typical behavior of well-organized electrochemical reaction. And here we are very close to here. Now the amount of mercury that we have is the amount of mercury that we have here is very very little. And then nevertheless we have comparable currents. So this means that we have some electrocatalysis. We moved further to zinc deposition. Here you can see some further analytical work through impedance spectroscopy of this simple reaction, and we see here the diffusion part, which demonstrate the Warburg type behavior, and here we can see the behavior of zinc deposition, which again show unique features on the nanoparticle, solid nanoparticle of mercury compared to graphene oxide, and of course even to mercury. And then we went to the most important electrochemical study, the hydrogen evolution reaction. It is well known that hydrogen evolution reaction on mercury is very lousy. In fact, the overpotential of hydrogen release at this is an old chart when we use different way of expressing electrochemical behavior, with minus going to the right and the negative current going to upward. So here we can see comparison between platinum, silver, and mercury, and it's well known that on mercury the electrochemical reaction is very lousy. But going further to the inspiring work of Bocris. Bocris, one of the fathers of modern chemistry, he worked on hydrogen evolution reaction on mercury, and these are some results that we pull out from our paper. But what is very, very important after we dig in the old literature is this statement. It appears that he did also hydrogen evolution reaction at very low temperature. And then there is a situation where you are at very low temperature and you measure the same reaction on liquid and then on solid, where the temperature difference is very small. And it appears that when he moved from liquid to solid, he always saw a jump in the overpotential. There was a considerable reduction of overpotential. So it appears that solid-state mercury behaved differently than liquid mercury. And with this, we went further. First of all, we had to see what, since we one of the reference of our references is reduced coffee oxide, and we have also mercury. It was very important to measure the surface and to see if we don't have a surface gain, simply gaining surface area. If you do electrocatalysis, of course, you have to make sure that you have variable areas. So, from this capacitive type behavior, look at the specific capacitance that we obtained. What is very important is here. So our system has 66 microfarad per centimeter, while the substrate, reduced graphene oxide, has much higher surface area. So here we have a very good comparison. So here, if we have a better situation, it's not because of the area, but rather because of electrocatalysis. So going further, here you have some, I'll show the entire story. So we did the right measurements of all the relevant substrates. And you can see here what happens on glassy carbon, and then on reduced carbon oxide and mercury. And here, this is our material. And it demonstrates, compared to the other, it demonstrates, of course, catalysis. It doesn't emit yet the performance of platinum nanoparticles, the classical catalyst for hydrogen pollution. But yet, compared to a true reference, we have definitely a catalysis. Now, from the further analysis of Taffer plots, in comparison to other reactions and to the hydrogen evolution reaction was studied for a while, we could come up with the following conclusion. So we have a mechanism in which we have this is a two-step reactions like this, which involve this type of equilibria, and we don't have this reaction. So we can say that we have the so-called Vollmer-Yarovsky type of model and not Vollmer-Taffer. And this is important, so we're able also to demonstrate a plausible mechanism of hydrogen evolution. And it appears that from these, I would say, preliminary studies, we have seen something interesting in terms of electrocatalysis as well. So after we successfully published the story, we could obtain some positive responses from different in interviews and comments in the popular literature, and we will really recognize that we discovered something real, and the implication is very important. So I come here to my last slide. The implications are indeed in electroanalysis and also electrocatalysis. So and it appears that we have here a general phenomena. So we can prepare nanoparticles of soft metals, especially mercury, on carbonaceous substrates, and we have something which is catalytic and can be used for both electroanalysis and electrocatalysis. So here, this completes the story. And special acknowledgement to my colleague and friend Aaron Gedanken, which is an inspiring scientist in the Department of Chemistry here, a very prolific leader in many areas. So I think that I should acknowledge very clearly our collaboration and his contribution to chemistry and to the Department of Chemistry here at Bar-Ilan University. And with this, I thank you very much for your attention.